Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? And we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
The greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels.
Violence returns to the streets of Hong Kong. The UN chief also urging world leaders to take the lead in the fight against climate change.
Carmina Constantine bringing you the latest news Monday to Friday at 12 noon on Dateline Philippines.
The health department says a Delta variant has already been detected in 13 out of the 17 regions in the Philippines.
The Philippines now back to a high-risk classification for COVID-19 amid surging cases.
The cachet distribution in Metro Manila set to begin on Wednesday.
And Filipino Olympic medalists Nesty Petesho, Carlo Paalam, and Yumir Marshall now back home after being part of the country's most successful run in the Olympics.
Good afternoon, I'm Ron Crew.
And I'm Denise Dinsai.
You're watching Top Stories. Philippines has logged 8,900 new cases today, taking the total to 1,667,000. Active cases have now climbed to 78,000, the highest since April 24th. The 21.3% positivity rate, meanwhile, is the highest since April 10. The health department clarifies the relatively low case count today is due to lower laboratory output last Saturday. Six more COVID-related deaths were recorded. Nearly 8,000 individuals were tagged as recovered.
13 of the Philippines' 17 regions have now detected the Delta COVID variant. The health department says the National Capital Region has the most cases of the highly infectious strain at 146. It is followed by Calabarzon, Central Luzon, Central Visayas, and Western Visayas. Nationwide, the Philippines has recorded 450 Delta variant cases, 13 of which are active. But the health department insists the variant is still not the dominant COVID strain in the country.
Our number one still is Beta variant, followed by the Alpha variant at about 25 and 23% respectively, while the Delta variant accounts for about 5% of the total specimens sequenced by the PGC. The PGC results of their sequencing is not meant to guide clinical management. Basta alam mo positive RT-PCR, which is still the gold standard, you manage it already. Mm-hmm. And you assume, by the way, as we have been saying, that whatever case that you come across, at least from the clinical standpoint, it's best to assume it's Delta.
A worrying study on the Delta variant out of the United Kingdom. Scientists at Public Health England say there are early signs that people vaccinated against COVID-19 may be able to transmit the more contagious variant as easily as those who are not. Their findings agree with that of the U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, which raised concerns last week that vaccinated people infected with the Delta variant could readily transmit the virus, unlike with other variants. The Delta variant has become the dominant COVID-19 mutation globally, sustaining a pandemic that has already killed 4.4 million people worldwide.
The Philippines now back to a high-risk classification for COVID-19 as the threat of the more contagious Delta variant lingers. The health department says the growth rate of COVID-19 cases in the country jumped to 47% in the past 2 weeks. An average of nearly 9,000 new cases were recorded daily in the first 7 days of August. That's over 2,000 cases higher than the daily average in the previous week.
We would like to flag the National Capital Region, Region of CAR, Region 1, Region 2, Region 4A, Region 7, and Region 10 with high-risk case classification based on its moderate risk 2-week growth rate and high-risk average daily attack rate. Local Delta cases had been detected in 13 out of our 17 regions in the country.
Malacañang hopes the current hard lockdown in various parts of the country will help control the spike in cases.
Inaasahan po natin na ang ECQ ay magdudulot na mas mababang numero pagdating po sa mga nahahawa ng COVID-19. Ito po yung magbibigay ng pagkakataon para mapalawak pa natin ang ating critical care capacity at inaasahan po natin ang resulta matapos po ang 2 weeks.
On July 1st, the DOH declared the Philippines as a low-risk country for COVID-19. But weeks after, the classification was elevated to moderate and now high-risk following the detection of local Delta variant cases.
The main COVID-19 treatment in the Ilocos Norte running out of hospital beds. The chief of the Mariano Marcos Memorial Hospital in Batac City says they're also looking to augment their staff with 200 of their workers currently undergoing quarantine. The hospital chief also hopes more COVID-19 vaccines can be sent to their city.
We have not really been given as much vaccines as the problem areas in Mindanao, Visayas, even NCR. So, but then we were having very few cases then. And I was quiet about it because I knew a lot of NCR people needed the vaccines and we would get our share anyway. But, and then this vaccine started coming. It was just about the time where the more cases started popping up.
COVID-19 wards and critical care units of both the Quezon City and Taguig branches of St. Luke's Medical Center are now full. In a statement, the hospital also says they still have patients waiting for admission in their emergency rooms. St. Luke's is now urging patients to consider other medical institutions should they need immediate care.
COVID-19 cases have been rising across all age groups in the Philippines. That's according to the health department as the country battles the spread of the more contagious Delta variant. It says a 59% increase in cases was recorded across all age brackets between July 13 and 25. The highest jump was observed among the 30 to 39 age group, while the lowest was among those 80 years old and above.
Private hospitals in the Philippines admitting more children with COVID-19. Dr. Jose Rene de Grano of the Private Hospitals Association of the Philippines says this is on top of the pediatric patients being confined for other seasonal diseases.
Napapasabay yan dun sa pagtaas talaga ng mga sakit ngayon, di ba, sa pag third quarter po ng taon, dumarating yung mga dengue, typhoid, ganyan, yung mga flu. Kaya nagsasabayan po yan at talagang marami ding bata na naapektuhan.
Hospitals are also on high alert for a rare condition among kids with COVID-19. That's after one young COVID patient in the Philippine General Hospital was found to have developed the multi-system inflammatory syndrome in children, or MIS-C. This results in the inflammation of bodily organs such as the heart, lungs, kidneys, brain, and even the skin. Some of its symptoms are fever, diarrhea, vomiting, and rashes.
As more children contract COVID-19, Health Secretary Duque says he supports proposals to vaccinate minors against the disease. But he notes this can only be done if there is sufficient supply, and a prioritization scheme should also be followed among younger recipients. Minors are yet to be included in the Philippine government's vaccination priority list, even as the Food and Drug Administration approved the use of Pfizer's vaccine for those aged 12 to 17.
Supply permitting, I wouldn't mind that we should already start vaccinating children for as long as first we prioritize which among the children. Those with comorbidities, of course, let's vaccinate them.
As for using booster shots, Duque asserts it's not recommended at this time.
It's against policy. It's against IATF resolution because we have to have a two-dose vaccination. We need to raise the coverage of our A1, A2, A3, and the rest of the groups. We have to vaccinate the priority groups first. Let's get them to the highest possible coverage, at least 90 to 95% for A2. And while we haven't reached those figures yet, the talk about booster doses has no place at this point. So let's prioritize.
Philippine pandemic officials planning to increase the daily vaccination target to up to 1 million doses. Vice President Lenny Robredo earlier urged government to administer at least 750,000 jabs a day during Metro Manila's two-week lockdown due to the threat of the Delta variant. The average daily administered doses in the past week is at 516,000. But National Task Force Against COVID-19 Deputy Chief Implementer Vince Dizon admits the success of the vaccination drive largely depends on vaccine supply.
Mawagang-galang na po kay Vice President Manny, pero in fact, antayin po natin sa vaccine cluster sa pamumuno ni Secretary Galvez, ang tatargetin po natin ay aabot na ng 1 million. Yun ang target natin. It is more than the 750,000. Nung nakarang linggo po, nag-high na po tayo ng 710,000. And ang panawagan po natin is agad tayo sana magtulong-tulongan na para maabot natin itong mga target. Again, ang pinakamalaking hamon pa rin natin ay supply. At ito ay hamon hindi lang ng Pilipinas, kundi hamon ng buong mundo. Kung tayo po ay may sapat na supply at makukuha po natin ang ating mga doses na pinangako ng ibang mga manufacturers sa iba't ibang bansa, eh kakayanin po natin at tinatarget natin is even much higher than the 750,000 hanggang 1 million kada araw. Basta may supply.
Nearly 11.4 million Filipinos are already fully vaccinated against COVID-19, while over 13 million have received their first dose.
The Philippine Food and Drug Administration evaluating the emergency use application of the Novavax COVID-19 vaccine. Novavax claims its vaccine has an efficacy rate of about 90% against COVID-19 based on a study of nearly 300,000 people from the U.S. and Mexico. But there's still no data on how effective it is against variants of concern.
Sa ngayon po, wala pa po. Ano, yung pong nakita kong original nila na submission ay wala pa. Pero mukhang baka naman po may pahabol pa sila. Usually naman po, basta complete ang requirements, it takes us 21 days. No? Yun yung maximum na sireset natin.
Cavite Governor John Vic Rimulya says the province will procure millions of doses from Novavax once it secures FDA authorization. Cavite is one of the provinces experiencing a surge in COVID-19 cases.
Kakamintin lang namin on Thursday ng Faberco, we have reiterated our desire to purchase 1.5 million doses and another 1 million early next year para makompleto natin ang herd immunity dito sa Cavite.
Malacanang says President Duterte's pronouncements are not to blame for the chaos at some vaccination sites last Thursday. The president earlier said he will order authorities to escort unvaccinated people back to their homes if they are seen outside. But his spokesman notes thousands of people only flocked to vaccination sites several days after Duterte made that remark.
Kung talagang reaction po yan na sa sinabi ni Presidente, dapat po yan ay nagsiksika na Tuesday pa lang o Wednesday. No? Pero hindi po nangyari yun. No? Wala pong pagkakamali ang ating Presidente sa kanyang pananalita. At kung paniniwalaan po natin ang mga surveys, no? The President remains to be the best communicator and the best positive communicator in the country today.
All 17 areas affected by the hard lockdown in Metro Manila will simultaneously begin receiving cash aid this Wednesday. Beneficiaries will include those who received assistance during the first two enhanced community quarantines. Around 10.7 million residents are entitled to a 1,000 peso cash aid or 4,000 pesos per family. This will be distributed over a span of 15 days.
Mix pong pagbibigay po niyan, merong electronic wallet at meron din pong face-to-face, pero sisiguraduhin po namin na may protocol po na maayos pamimigay. Magkakaroon po ng alphabetical yung ating beneficiary o kaya area by area.
As for the Labor Department, it says it will provide jobs to displaced workers.
Bibigyan namin sila ng 10 days of work and then bibigyan namin yung sweldo nila. Eh, dahil NCR naman, and ang minimum wage dito sa NCR is 537 per day. Last 10 days, that means that we will give them 5,370. Yan. Yan ha, buo yan, Angelo. Buo, walang kartas yan. Kasi ang aming pagbayad sa kanila is through remittance center.
The local government of Pasig provides food packs for families who are not included in the list of cash aid beneficiaries. Katrina Domingo now joins us for more updates. Go ahead, Kat.
Hi, Denise. The Pasig City government has spent $88.24 million for the purchase of food packs for 260,000 families who would fail to receive cash aid from the national government during the lockdown of Metro Manila. The food sacks containing rice, canned goods, and other essential items are worth around 340 pesos each and will be distributed again to indigent families that will not be included in this round of lockdown cash aid. Pasig City Mayor Vico Soto tells us the local government only received 650 million pesos for the social amelioration program during Metro Manila's third lockdown. Now, this amount is about 30 million pesos lower compared to the 680 million pesos Pasig City received during the Philippines' first enhanced community quarantine in 2020. Mayor Soto says some Pasigueños will have to settle for food tax this time around as the city no longer has sufficient funds to distribute more cash aid during this lockdown. If we can recall, Pasig City spent 1.2 billion pesos from its coffers in 2020 to fund its own cash aid program last year. That's on top of the cash aid program of the national government in 2020. Now, Denise, these packets of money from the national government will be given to Pasigueños through small distribution centers starting on August 11. Soto says the city chose not to distribute these funds through online payment channels as the poorest of the poor in the city do not have access to smartphones and stable internet connection. Soto admits it will also be a challenge for the city government to distribute the 650 million peso fund in 15 days. As their distribution teams may encounter COVID positive patients or unfavorable weather, as well as other unpredictable circumstances. Meantime, Denise, Mayor Soto's also slammed reports grading or ranking local chief executives based on the efficiency and speed of their COVID-19 vaccination program, saying these are not accurate and are unfair. Soto says the flow of vaccine supply is out of the hands of mayors, so local chief executives technically have no say on how many constituents they could vaccinate against COVID-19. Denise.
Thank you, Kat.
Residents of Laguna and Bataan also set to receive financial aid from the government. Laguna returned to enhanced community quarantine last Friday until August 15. Bataan, meanwhile, was placed under ECQ from August 8 to 22. Malacanang says the budget department has proposed 2.7 billion pesos for the aid in Laguna. The agency is still computing the budget for Bataan's cash aid.
Philippine Police Chief Guillermo Eleazar says people who have medical appointments will now be allowed to cross intercity boundaries despite the hard lockdown in Metro Manila. Eleazar says they will be considered other authorized persons outside of residence. People who need to travel due to family emergencies will also now be allowed to cross borders. Eleazar, however, continues to remind the public to just stay home as much as possible.
Meaning to say, they can cross boundary already. And we have discussed that. At yan po yung na-disseminate natin sa ating mga quarantine control points. Kung kayo naman po is mayroong appointment ng inyo for medical reason, like for example, lalo na kung may mga chemotherapy, dialysis, eh yan po ay siyempre sa hospital na inyong alam o nakasanayan na, and you can cross border. Ngayon, sa ibang mga appointment, like dental appointment, medical check-up, inaallow na rin po yun na mag-cross kayo ng border. Pero ang aming po pinakikiusap sana, since ECQ naman, kung pwede naman na makahintayan after ECQ, pinakamaganda po. Pero kung talagang papasok siya dun sa emergency, wala pong problema.
Several overseas Filipino workers set to leave for Hong Kong stranded in Manila due to concerns regarding the territory's vaccination policy. The vaccination cards, which were issued by local government units in the Philippines, are not recognized by Hong Kong's government. Hong Kong and Macau Bayan Chairman Eman Villanueva says Filipino authorities are now coordinating with officials in the territory to settle the matter. Villanueva appeals to Philippine officials to provide assistance to those affected OFWs.
Over in the U.S., America's top infectious diseases expert says vaccine hesitancy could lead to COVID-19 mutations worse than the Delta variant. Dr. Anthony Fauci warns if more people will continue to resist getting inoculated against COVID-19, variants resistant to the current crop of vaccines may emerge.
The vaccines do quite well against Delta, particularly in protecting you from severe disease. But if you give the virus a chance to continue to change, you're leading to a vulnerability that we might get a worse variant, and then That will impact not only the unvaccinated, that will impact the vaccinated, because that variant could evade the protection of the vaccine. So people who are unvaccinated should think about their own health, that of their family, but also the community responsibility to crush this virus before it becomes even worse.
The U.S. has reported an average of 100,000 new COVID-19 cases for the past days as the Delta variant rips through the country among unvaccinated people. About 400 people are dying daily, while hospitalizations are at the highest since last February.
Australia's most populous state, New South Wales, expands its lockdown. It now covers the rural town of Tamworth amid concerns the coronavirus may have spread into the countryside.
The epicenter of the virus in New South Wales and Sydney still remains the Canterbury Bankstown local government area. We are seeing some stabilisation in other local government areas, but that local government area is proving to demonstrate the virus is still circulating. And we also ask people in those adjoining suburbs to the Canterbury Bankstown local government area to especially be on high alert. That remains the greatest challenge for us.
New South Wales reported over 280 locally acquired COVID cases, despite its capital, Sydney, entering its seventh week of lockdown. High school students from the city's hotspot areas have been getting their first vaccine doses amid criticisms over Australia's sluggish vaccine rollout. You see, only 22% of Australians above 16 years of age are fully vaccinated.
Chinese cities conducting more rounds of mass testing as it tries to arrest the resurgence of infections. Mainland China reported 125 new infections, including 94 locally transmitted cases. The highly infectious Delta variant has been detected in more than a dozen cities since July 20th. In Wuhan, where the virus first emerged in 2019, a mass testing on all of its 11 million residents yielded 41 local asymptomatic carriers.
Over in Malaysia, government is set to ease restrictions for fully vaccinated people in some states. Prime Minister Muhyiddin Yassin said Sunday, dining at restaurants, interstate tourism, and home quarantine upon returning from abroad will now be allowed for fully vaccinated individuals. The new measures will only be implemented in states with low case numbers and high vaccination rates. This does not include the capital, Kuala Lumpur, and surrounding areas where infection rates remain the highest in the nation. Malaysia has been in lockdown since June 1st due to a spike in infections. Still ahead, another political party backs a possible presidential bid of Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte Carpio.
And Philippine shares soar following an upward revision of the country's first quarter GDP figure. More news when we return.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Welcome back. You're still watching Top Story. Another political party backing the possible presidential bid of President Duterte's daughter, Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte Carpio. The president of Laban ng Demokratikong Pilipino, Senator Sonny Angara, confirms his party will support the mayor if she decides to run in 2022. This comes a day after Hugpong ng Pagbabago Secretary General Anthony Del Rosario said other parties have also committed their support for the younger Duterte. These include the Lakas Christian Muslim Democrats of former President Gloria Arroyo and Puwersa ng Masang Pilipino of former President Joseph Estrada. Nationalist People's Coalition Chairman and Senate President Vicente Soto III is unfazed by Duterte's increasing supporters. Soto, who campaigned for Angara in the 2019 midterms, is expected to run for vice president alongside Senator Panfilo Lacson.
Vice President Lenny Robredo explains why she rejected the unification offer from presidential candidate Senator Panfilo Lacson. During her Sunday radio show, Robredo revealed that the plan required all opposition candidates to file their certificates of candidacy, then later withdraw to support the survey frontrunner. But Robredo said she did not like the idea of just stringing her supporters along. Opposition coalition Isambayan also sees several flaws in Lacson's plan.
Ayoko na parang nilead on namin yung supporters. Ang paniniwala ko, pag may isang kandidato ng certificate of candidacy, pinipresenta na namin sa publiko ang sarili namin eh. Yung mga naniniwala sa amin, tapa yan.
Gulo lang po ang mangyayari niyan. What we should do is really kung tayo po talaga ay gusto ng unity, and then we should be selfless enough that we should come to the unity table with the best intentions ng ating pamahalaan, ng ating country, at ng ating mamamayan.
Lacson says he respects Robredo's decision to decline his offer. Another opposition group, the Makabayan Bloc, meanwhile is hoping the talks about possible unification will continue.
We can no longer take it for another 6 years of this kind of governance that we have now under the Duterte administration. Na hindi na natin payagan na magtutuloy-tuloy pa itong ganitong klase, no, na pahirap, pasakit, at pasistang pamamahala sa ating bayan.
Let's check on the weather here in the Philippines with Pagasa forecaster Chris Perez. Chris?
Good afternoon. So far, we are expecting the effect of the southwest monsoon and the trough of the low-pressure area to bring cloudy skies and scattered rain showers and thunderstorms over the Cagayan Valley, Mimaropa, Ilocos Provinces, Apayao, the whole Visayas, Bicol Region, Zamboanga Peninsula, Northern Mindanao, and Caraga. Residents of these areas are advised to be alert against possible flash floods and landslides. Generally, partly cloudy to cloudy skies with some isolated rain showers or thunderstorms will prevail over Metro Manila and the rest of the country. Meanwhile, we are monitoring a low-pressure area which was estimated at about 335 kilometers east of Borongan City, Eastern Samar. Now, this is a small chance of developing into a tropical cyclone within 12 to 24 hours. However, we will continue to monitor and provide updates to the general public through our public weather forecast to be issued at 4 a.m. tomorrow morning. And that's the latest here at Pagasa Weather Forecasting Center. I'm Chris Perez reporting for ANC.
Thanks, Chris.
Overseas, at least 8 people are missing in California as a massive Dixie wildfire rages on. Here's the full story.
Officials on Sunday said the raging Dixie fire in Northern California is now the second largest recorded in the state's history, days after the blaze destroyed a historic gold rush town and forced the evacuation of thousands. State fire officials said the massive wildfire had grown to almost 500,000 acres as of Sunday morning and was 21% contained. Only last year's August complex fire, which consumed more than 1 million acres, was bigger. So far, no deaths have been attributed to the wildfire, but at least 8 people were missing as of late Saturday. 5 of the missing belong to the old mining town of Greenville, where the fire leveled most of its downtown about 160 miles north of Sacramento. The cause of the fire remains under investigation. Pacific Gas and Electric has said it may have started when a tree fell on one of the utility's power lines.
Wildfires also burning in Greece. A resident who had to flee her home says the sight of the massive fires looked like it was plucked from a horror movie. Take a look.
Thousands of people have fled their homes on the Greek island of Evia as wildfires burned uncontrolled for a sixth day on Sunday, and ferries were on standby for more evacuations after taking many to safety by sea. The fires on Evia, Greece's second biggest island, ripped through thousands of acres of pristine forest across its northern part and forced the evacuation of dozens of villages. The flames engulfed homes in five villages, but the full extent of the damage was not immediately known.
We are afraid. We feel lost. We feel abandoned.
38-year-old evacuee Mina, who is pregnant, said seeing the blaze was like watching a horror movie.
You see the horror movie, you got afraid, and you tell to yourself, okay, this is a movie. But now, this is not the movie. This is our real life. This is horror that we live for the last 1 week, almost 1 week.
Wildfires have broken out in many parts of Greece during a week-long heat wave, the country's worst in three decades, with searing temperatures and hot winds creating tinderbox conditions. Across the country, forest land has burned and dozens of homes and businesses have been destroyed. Since Tuesday, the Coast Guard has evacuated more than 2,000 people, including many elderly residents from different parts of Evia, where more than 570 firefighters are battling two active blazes in the north and south of the island. Greece has deployed the army to help battle the fires, and several countries, including France, Egypt, Switzerland, and Spain, have also sent help, including firefighting aircraft.
Philippine shares break a two-day losing streak as investors cheer an upward revision in the country's first quarter GDP print. Rain Musi reports.
Philippine shares soar 1.4%, besting Asian peers for the day. The main index broke through the 6,600 resistance. Value turnover was respectable despite a second session of foreign fund selling. Regina Capital Development Corporation says investors have been buying stocks ahead of the potential bounce in economic growth in the second quarter of the year. As for Jovis Vistan of AB Capital Securities, he attributes the rally to the upward revision of the country's first quarter GDP figure.
The catalyst today was really the news that we had a preview of what sort of GDP numbers to look forward to in tomorrow's report. The news was the revision of the first quarter contraction from 4.2%, as you mentioned, to just 3.9%. And the series of second quarter corporate earnings results that have come out are obviously much better because of the lower base. So all of these provided a positive backdrop for tomorrow's announcement of the GDP results.
As long as the second quarter growth data is not lower than 10%, Vistan says the market may see the main index surge back to the 6,800 level. April Lee Tan of COL Financial agrees and expects the Philippine Central Bank to keep interest rates unchanged at its policy setting meeting on Thursday. Still, she says there's a reason to be cautious.
Well, it's quite unfortunate that we're in a period of no interest. You know, a lot of cautiousness because, you know, the economy is recovering, but it's not something that you would really be excited about. That's why there is no urgency in buying. And of course, we now have this lockdown, which is another downside risk for earnings.
I think investors want to have a, you know, better idea of how things will turn out before they will have a stronger conviction. But we are recommending investors to take advantage of the depressed prices of stocks to start coming in and start accumulating.
For the day, the mining and oil index fell 1.8% after sharp falls in gold and oil prices spooked sentiment across Asia. Meanwhile, the stock price of Kep Wealth Property Philippines plunged 10% after reporting profits also plummeting 95% in the second quarter. Its shares are now worth less than its 2019 IPO price of 5 pesos and 74 centavos per share. Rain Musngi, ABS-CBN News.
After five straight quarters of contraction, Philippine Central Bank Governor Benjamin Jokno is confident Tuesday's second quarter GDP report will show a return to growth. But Jokno says it's still not the time to raise interest rates, citing the need to keep supporting the economy following renewed lockdowns in Metro Manila and other parts of the country. Reserve requirement ratio cuts also not on the table during the BSP's policy meeting on Thursday.
We will continue to our monetary policy accommodation as long as necessary to ensure that the economic recovery is sustainable and strong. While I'm committed to reduce the RRR to single digit before the end of my term, which is in 2023, cutting it now is untimely and not justified. There's still a lot of liquidity in the system.
A Philippine senator sounds the alarm over the negative impact of abrupt commercial restrictions on micro, small, and medium enterprises, or MSMEs. Senator Grace Poe has filed a resolution urging the Senate to look into their plight, especially the food and beverage industry. Poe says food and beverage establishments were caught off guard when government announced a ban on dine-in services just a day before it would take effect.
They are all in agreement that a lockdown, perhaps to stall the spread of the virus, is necessary, but at least give them some lead time. And I think the reason why this came about is there's really not a direct communication, line of communication between the policymakers of the IATF and the small business owners. It's important that I think that we should have an IATF focused on economic recovery. Now, why is this important? MSMEs in particular compose 99% of businesses in the country. We know that. That's about a million businesses and about 5 million people at the minimum rely on these MSMEs. Now, at this point, 10% of the MSMEs already shut down. They're predicting about 16% more, or up until 16% this year alone.
But the palace rejects this.
Ma'am, hindi po gobyerno ang nagbigay ng danyo sa ating mga maliliit na mga mambuhunan. COVID-19 po yan. At hindi po mabilis kasi ako nga po mismo ang nag-move ng isang ligong palugit para magkaroon ng pagkakataon nga ang ating mga taong bayan na paghandaan itong ECQ. So hindi po totoo yung paratang ninyo. For your information lang po.
Local pump prices are set to go down this week. Gasoline prices may be slashed by up to 90 centavos per liter. Meanwhile, diesel and kerosene prices may see a price cut of up to 80 centavos per liter. Industry players say the decline in prices was mainly triggered by rising COVID-19 cases in the U.S. and China, which are dimming the recovery outlook in oil demand. Meanwhile, power distributor Meralco is implementing another electricity rate hike for the fifth straight month. It announced an increase of 0.09 centavos per kilowatt hour, citing higher transmission charges. This translates to a 19 peso increase for customers who consume 200 kilowatt hours per month.
More news overseas. The Biden administration appearing to shrug off a new campaign from U.S. business groups calling on Washington to remove Trump-era tariffs. More than 30 groups wrote to Biden's top trade and economic officials last week, urging them to work with Beijing towards fully removing tariffs imposed from the U.S.-China trade war during the Trump administration. But the U.S. Trade Representative's office did not comment on the status of the tariffs, saying the China policy is still in review. According to recent data, China continues to lag far behind the purchasing targets it agreed to when the trade deal was signed in January 2020. In that deal, China committed to buying an additional $200 billion worth of U.S. goods by 2021 in exchange for a partial cut in American tariffs.
Still on U.S.-China tensions, Beijing calls on Washington to respect Chinese sovereignty and stop interfering in Hong Kong's affairs. China's latest statement issued Sunday was in response to U.S. President Joe Biden's move of offering Hong Kong residents temporary safe haven status as he condemns what it calls China's crackdown on democracy in the city. Under the offer, Hong Kong residents can live and work in the U.S. for 18 months. But Beijing says Biden's move blatantly defames the law of China on safeguarding national security in Hong Kong. It added the memorandum is a clear example of what it calls Washington's vile behavior in meddling in Hong Kong's affairs.
Chinese e-commerce giant Alibaba facing backlash due to sexual assault allegations. More in this report.
Chinese tech giant Alibaba has fired a manager accused of sexually assaulting a female employee. That's according to a memo by chief executive Daniel Zhang, seen by Reuters. The company is already under pressure from a regulatory crackdown. Now it's dealing with an uproar on social media set off by the accusations. A female employee made the claims in an 11-page document uploaded onto Alibaba's internal network. In her account, she said she was assaulted during a business trip with the manager, who was her boss, and a client in July. First, she said, the client kissed her. After drinking alcohol, she woke up in a hotel room the next day. She said she had no clothes on and no memory of what had happened. But CCTV footage from the hotel showed her boss had entered the room four times during the night. After reporting the incident, the employee said human resources had agreed to fire the boss and give her some time off, but had apparently not followed through. After making the rounds on Alibaba's internal network, the story went on to kick up a storm on social media. Alibaba has also suspended other staff members in connection to the case, and police say they're investigating. In a statement, Zhang said, quote, starting from me, starting from management, starting from human resources, everyone at Alibaba must empathize, reflect, and take action. China's Me Too movement began in 2018 with an accusation of sexual harassment on a college campus. But Me Too soon came under pressure from authorities, with many cases still unresolved.
More to come, Filipino boxer Yumir Marshall shares his future plans after winning the bronze medal in the Tokyo Games. Stay with us.
Laban lang. Kahit worried kang magkasakit, eh kailangan magtrabaho. So, laban lang. Sandali anak, magpapalit lang si mami ha. Pride? Buti na lang, ang Pride palaban din.
Pride Antibac, may germ knockout action. Kills up to 99.9% of germs. Para sa labadang malinis.
Para tuloy ang lambingan, kailangan lumaban.
Pride, ang labadang malinis palaban sa germs.
Araw-araw sa eskwela, nagkakasubukan ng galing. Gaano ko galing ang bat soup mo?
Uy, araw! Agwi pa!
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Thank you. concluded Tokyo Olympics. The team, composed of Nesty Petesho, Carlo Paalam, Ymir Marshall, and Irish Magno, arrived at the Ninoy Aquino International Airport Terminal 2 in Pasay City at past 4 this afternoon. This is the first time in more than 2 decades that the Philippines clinched 3 medals at the boxing category. Paalam and Petesho both bagged silver medals at the men's flyweight and women's featherweight divisions, while Marshall won a bronze medal at the men's middleweight division. In total, the Philippines secured 4 Olympic medals. Haydarin Diaz earlier gave the country its first ever gold at the women's 55-kilogram weightlifting category. Malacanang attributes the success of Team Philippines in the 2020 Tokyo Olympics to the Duterte administration's heavy investment on Filipino athletes. Palace spokesman Harry Rojas says that it was no coincidence that the country took home its best ever Olympic medal haul during the Duterte administration.
Now, before their flight home, ANC's Migs Bustos was able to speak to bronze medalist Ymir Marshall on his plans for his multi-million peso cash reward and if he will still try to deliver the Philippines' first ever Olympic gold in boxing. Now, here's an excerpt of that interview.
So we have bronze medalist Ymir Marshall. Maraming salamat, Ymir, sa pagsali sa amin dito sa programa. Kamusta? Kamusta ang Olympic experience? Anong thoughts mo ngayon sa bronze medal finish mo?
Siyempre po, sobrang saya po dahil dati, pinapangarap ko lang na makatungtong sa Olympics, makuha yung gold. Pangarap pa lang yun dati, pero ngayon, bagamat hindi ko manakuha yung gold, nakatungtong po ako sa Olympic at nakapagbigay po ako ng medal para sa bansa po.
Ymir, kung may i-rate mo ang Olympic performance mo from 1 to 10, paano mo i-grade yun?
Siguro nasa 9 po dahil alam ko po na binigay ko po yung lahat, yung best ko. At sobrang close po yung fight, semifinal fights ko. At yun lang eh.
Siguro yung isa na yon, yun yung mga kulang at mga mistake na nagawa ko dapat na i-improve.
Ano naman ang pinakamalaki mong natutunan pagdating sa skill, sa mga kailangan mong improve sa buong Olympic journey mo?
Una na po, pinaka natutunan ko, pinaka importante po yung communication with your team, your coaches, mga tao na nakasama mo. Yung natutunan ko dito ay yung sportsmanship na pag lumalaban ka, kahit magkalaban kayo, pagdating mo sa ring, grabe bagbakan nyo, pero pagtapos ang laban, yung kaibigan kayo, magbatian kayo. So, syempre yung mga kulang at kailangan ko pa improve sa sarili ko, sa mga future na laban ko. So, yun po yung mga natutunan ko po dito.
Ngayon, Ymir, at least 7 million pesos in incentives. Saan mo ito unang gagastusin?
Siguro po, sa ngayon, syempre, inisip ko din yung future, future ko, future ng magiging pamilya ko dahil nagpaplano din po kami magkasal ng fiancé ko. Wala pa naman sa ngayon pero siyempre hopefully makapagsimula ng negosyo o yun, makapagtayo ng bahay para po sa magiging pamilya namin. And siyempre tulong po sa pamilya dahil yun po din talaga yung unang-unang goal ko. Bakit nandito ako sa boxing, dito ako sa sakripisyo para po sa pamilya ko na matulungan ko na makaahon sa kahirapan.
Ano nang next, Ymir? Alam ko ngayon, nasa airport kayo, papunta na kayo ng Maynila. Ano nang next ngayon ng mga pagpaplanuhan mo, mga tournament, mga fight? Tapos siguro, baka curious yung mga viewers kung Paris 2024 nga ba ang isa sa mga goals mo?
After nito, sir, pag-uwi ko, siguro mag-spend time sa pamilya. And then, siguro, mag-start ako ulit mag-training at maghanda po para sa mga pro fights na darating sa akin.
Paris 2024, isa ba yun sa mga goals mo?
Yes po sir, yung pangarap ko na makakuha ng gold sa Olympics, nandito pa rin yun sir at kumbaga sinubukan pa ako ng Panginoon, binigyan pa ako ng kumbaga pagsubok na anak ko gusto mo magsikap pa ako lalo. So yan, yun po yung goal ko. Yan yun po yung pangarap ko. Hanggang malakas po ako, hanggang makapag-represent po ako ng, sa bansa natin, talagang i-grab ko po yun.
Message mo sa viewers natin, Yumir.
Sa mga nanonood po at sa lahat po ng mga Pilipino, lubos po ako nagpapasalamat sa masuporta at sa dasal. Nung lumalaban po kami dito sa Tokyo Olympics, talagang ramdam na ramdam po namin yung suporta ng lahat ng mga Pilipino. So yun po yung isa din sa mga nagbigay ng lakas amin. So sobra po ako nagpapasalamat at sana po suportahan pa nila kami sa mga darating na laban. At kami naman ay magbibigay kami at gagawin namin lahat yung best namin para po matagumpay at magbigay ng karangalan para sa ating bansa. So, maraming salamat po, sir.
And those were the top stories today. I'm Denise Dinsai.
And I'm Ron Cruz. You can watch exclusive content and highlights and recaps of our shows online. Thanks for watching. We'll be right back.